Basically, we wanted to say good afternoon. Because of the delay, now I have to say good evening to everybody. It's my pleasure to welcome all you for this session. Before I could go into the details of GST, let me introduce the expert on the GST now, Mr. Chirag Mehta. He is a rank holder in BCom, Mumbai University, ranked 10th in Mumbai University, All India ranked 26th in intermediate CA exam. He is a faculty in seminar organized by professional business associations. Contributor of a lot of articles in various professional magazines. Certified accredited GST trainer, which is what you are basically looking for. Issued by CBSE through NACN and arm of the Government of India. He is also a committee member of professional associations such as member of indirect taxation and core group committee of Bombay Chartered Accountants of India. He is also convener of IDT study circle BCAS. He is now the proprietor of CB Mehta Associate Chartered Accountant Firm. First thing is all these sessions we have gone through, we could find out at least 5 or 6 panelists where they have been talking for quite a long time, where very little time was given for the audience to ask questions. This is going to be the other way around. So I am also part of you, and I am also going to ask him only questions. Basically, now I don't know what, maybe there's only one panelist here, and as we all know, the GST, the burning issue today, there are two contradicting things. One is an expert on GST, other one is always confused about the GST. That's me, okay. The total session was given only 30 minutes. I don't know, for the reasons unknown to me, maybe because we thought that people may not ask more questions or they may ask more questions, I don't know. Okay, so I want to confirm myself only the impact of the GST to our industries. Though we know GST per se is a major problem for all the industries, but let's sort out our own problem, then we'll get into the other things. In fact, when I was interacting to a couple of our colleagues, when I was asking about the impact on the GST, some of them say, look, we may like you to save 3 to 4% on the inputs. Some of them say, no, there may not be any impact at all. We don't know, because it is too early to decide what is the impact on your input, whatever ITC. As we know, we have been enjoying certain transitional ITCs, there are other things. So let's wait for, as far as I am concerned, maybe next 2-3 months, we may not be able to conclude what is the direct impact on the GST. I'm sure expert will give a more explanation on that. See, there's only advantage of GST, what I'm trying to say is, the law very clearly says it's a furtherance of the business. See, unlike our earlier VAT Act, this is where you are not eligible for various inputs. Now the furtherance of the business could be anything. So that the input available for the conduct of the business, or more specifically furtherance of the business, is a major advantage what I feel here. Of course, there are a lot of complications in terms of procedural thing. We are still not clear whether GSTR1 to be filed, what is a GSTR155 file, what will happen if the other fellow is not filed, my invoices. There are so many things, there are a lot of confusions around. So I would like to be more of this session to be an interaction session, post Mr. Mehta's explanation about the GST, to make maximum use of his expertise so that we sail through these GST issues. With this, I would like to invite expert Mehta to take forward the workshop. Post Mr. Mehta's lecture, you can ask questions. Anyway, we have got a set of questions which has been sent to me by the industry, which I would also read out. Subsequently, you can ask your questions. Over to Mr. Mehta.
So let me first thank Indian Ice Cream Congress to give me this opportunity to speak on the BJP-delivered GST. Okay. A very premature delivery, I would say, because it was delivered even before we do our prenatal classes. That how do we handle GST issues? How do we handle this new baby? The new baby is too small to eat ice cream, but ice cream industry has to take care of this new baby. what is the change? The change is from the tax incidence, the taxable event. So we had various taxable events where excise was on manufacture, VAT or CST was on sale, service tax was levied on provision of service, everything consolidated to have one taxable event, that is supply. So the tax, which is GST, is on supply. Terms like sale, service are all of the past. What we have to ask ourselves before we have to answer the question whether GST applies or no, there has to be a supply for GST to apply. So what is supply? So I went through various questions that Narasimhanji sent to me. So broad question was e-way bill, or what we know in the past is delivery challan. Whether the movement of goods should go under an invoice, yes. If it is a supply, the movement should happen on a tax invoice. If it is not on a challan, the movement will happen on a delivery challan, or as in when the e-way bill comes, which should take around 2 to 3 months from now, the movement would be on an e-way bill where the movement is not in the course of supply. So what is important is the term supply. Few areas which are of concern, the heart of GST, input tax credit. That heart can function only if the compliance is done correctly, and the heart to good compliance is good accounting. Till now, input tax credit in case of manufacturers of ice cream was not too relevant as far as excise was concerned, because I believe most of y'all were paying excise duty on that abatement route where there was no input tax credit available. Yes, to the extent of the local VAT, the state level VAT, you were claiming credits. As far as the retail outlet companies are concerned, they were claiming credit of the VAT and paying tax on whatever B2C sales they were doing to consumer. So what has changed now? The change is the matching of the input tax credit. Correct accounting, sanitizing of vendors, creating masters, reviewing masters, ensuring that you have vendors who are compliant, whom you know since a long time, sanitizing new added vendors to ensure that there is no mismatch. So broadly, there are three returns that we are going to file. GSTR 1, 2 and 3. So as far as the stores are concerned, the GSTR 1 is going to be simple because it's going to be a B2C sale which you're going to report on a consolidated basis. So most of the stores would be operating locally. Their sales would also be local. So when you report those sales, you have to just report one figure of B2C sales, the tax rate and the tax amount. Tax amount would be CGST and SGST because you're doing a local sale. Few ice cream stores would also engage in supplying ice creams to catering firms across the state, where you would definitely levy IGST and the caterer would claim credit of whatever you levy. So broadly, you have three models, CGST, SGST and IGST. Wherever the supply is taking place across states, you would levy IGST, that is integrated tax. And when the supply is from the store on a B2C basis, on a B2C model, what you would levy is CGST and SGST. So one question which comes to the mind of the stores is, do we issue a tax invoice for every supply across the counter? Yes, every supply, whether it involves movement or whether it is given across the counter, issuing a tax invoice is mandatory. Not only issuing the tax invoice, but tax invoice with all the particulars is also important. But I feel that most of the outlets are not still complying. I'm not talking about only ice cream industry. You go to any food mall, any outlet, you go to a Farsan store, everyone is still giving the old bill, which just says, list down the item and the amount. So what we did for our clients is we started sending our office staff to go and insist to the outlet that I want an invoice, I want to do a B2B purchase, and I want my GST to be mentioned on the tax invoice. And most of the store managers replied that no, we are not supposed to issue a tax invoice. So what the outlet need to take care, today it's a staff of a chartered accountant firm, tomorrow it may be an officer visiting that outlet. I'm not saying the offense is serious, but we should try and inculcate and try to manage this change. We should try to automate the POS as much as possible to ensure that our POS supplier, the software supplier, is trying to integrate our system with what the law requires you to do. Reporting of the HS codes, yes, it is mandatory. Yes, even if it's a B2B sale, except the caterers, the other people cannot take credit because food is an ineligible in the negative list. So you, the person who's buying ice creams from you, unless he's into further supply, he cannot claim credit. But legally, if you're required to issue a tax invoice, you should do that. Coming to GSTR 2, where you have to report all your inward supplies. So we are not talking about purchase of ice cream from the manufacturer, but we are talking about each and every item which is on the debit of your profit and loss account. I would like to repeat that each and every item, we are moving from the term purchase to the term inward supply. Inward supply includes everything. Expense, capital expense, revenue expenditure, purchase, packing material, finished goods, ice creams, everything. So when you talk about claiming credit, so you as suppliers of ice cream, be it a manufacturer or be it a retail outlet, would be allowed to claim credit of every inward supply except if it is listed in the negative list. So it does not end there. First, your inward supply should be under the cover of a tax invoice with all the particulars, with the HS code. Then the next step is to report these transactions. So typically what issues we have faced at client end is the recording of the transaction in the accounting system itself is a problem. So passing correct entries, recording tax, so you have three taxes now. You have three taxes on the output side and you have three taxes on the input side. So your ledgers come to six. If you have a number of outlets, maybe you would be maintaining books for each outlet separately. So each outlet would have these six ledgers, so you can multiply the number of ledgers that you're creating in your accounts. Yes, but at the time of booking the entry, one very important thing which I think I should share with you is the document based on which you claim credit, that's the tax invoice issued by your vendor, has an invoice number and an invoice date. So typically what happens after transit, the movement ends at a date which is other than the date which is dated on the invoice. What is important is, so you would do a GRN on the date the goods are received by you or the date on which the service provider has provided the service invoice to you. And you would typically make the entry of that expenditure or purchase in your books of accounts. The basis for claiming credit based on which the matching is going to take place is the document date and not the entry date. So what errors we have come across while we are helping clients do compliance is that entry is made on the date the document comes to the accounts, which is wrong, which will lead to hassles when you actually upload the compliance. Next, how do we comply? So say typically a manufacturer would, depending on the size of the operation, would typically have 500 to 2000 inward invoices coming to him. Your accounting system would record those invoices, then would export it to a CSV or Excel file. Then you have two options. Either you use the government provided utility where you can upload these Excel files, and then that utility provides you with a file format which the GST portal can accept, which is called a JSON file. When the portal accepts that file, the portal at the back end would try and match what you have claimed to what the supplier has furnished. Alternatively, you have an option to opt for a GSP or ASP service. What is GSP or ASP? It is just a software which is being provided by a software vendor, which helps you do this matching even before the portal does it. So you have your purchase register or the expense register uploaded on this intermediate software. Then you have the download or the dump from the portal of what suppliers have furnished. This intermediate software will try and match what you have done. So what is the main error which comes is, one, the amount of tax. What is happening is, the amount of tax is coming in decimals. CGST 20.5 levied by the supplier. While making entries, the accountant enters it as 21. Okay? We do not have an officer verifying your entries. We have a software. So 20.5 is what you should have claimed. 21 is what you have claimed. So the system will say that you've claimed higher than what the supplier has disclosed, and it will go unmatched. Second error, the date, I've already mentioned that. Third error, invoice number. Everyone has their own style of invoice numbering. Obviously, you have a bar on the number of digits at 16. It can be alphanumeric, but it has to be identified to the financial year. So if you are issuing an invoice for financial year 17-18, you should identify as 1718 or 201718. So what errors come here? While punching, the accountant will punch the entry of the invoice number as 1718 instead of 201718 that the supplier has furnished. Again, you have a software verifying the entries. It will show you as mismatch. So what these intermediate softwares will do is would try and use the artificial intelligence that the software has embedded in itself to check where only one element of the invoice is not matching, but the other elements are matching. So what will happen is, before this file goes to the portal, you already have the software at least verifying entries where the supplier has made a GSTR1 furnishing. To that extent, it would not lead to a mismatch or a notice coming to you at a later date. Yes, but if the supplier has not filed his GSTR1, which since the dates have been extended, typically many suppliers, the smaller ones have not yet furnished their statement of outward supply in GSTR1. So the problem we are facing is that we are not able to file GSTR2 because we're still not getting enough credits from the supplier. So the best way is, the suggestion that I have is, you should wait for the supplier credits coming. Matching is just like a marriage. So before marriage, we match horoscopes. Out of 36, even if 18 match, we do the marriage. And it may unmatch later and lead to a divorce. But under GST, the matching has to be to the decimal. There cannot be one up, one down, no upward rounding off, no lower rounding off. You have to ensure that your accounting system, your internal controls are such that there is minimal. I'm sure the government is trying to create a balance, should have ideally thought about a balance between accuracy and practicality. But the government has chosen to ask us to be more accurate and not being practical. Doing an invoice level matching is unique to India. Most of the countries like Brazil and China, which have tried doing this, have failed. And I see either return periodicity going from monthly to quarterly, or they might just do away with invoice level matching, because we are experiencing serious issues in matching, especially using softwares without even having time for us to understand. So when he stated that we have an expert here, I am still learning. I'm not an expert, and we all still learning. So what we need to ensure is, yes, correct accounting and correct filing is the key to ensure that we do not have mismatch issues, and mismatch issues which also mean paying that tax with interest. So it's not going to be so easy to handle compliance under GST. And with that, I think if we can move on with few questions which you already have, I can answer them first.
Thanks a lot, Mr. Chirag Mehta, for that elaborate and wonderful explanation on GST. Let me go back to the question thing. When you're talking about when you talk about the accounting part of it, basically when you see what happens when the goods in transit, I do purchases a bill material being sent on a 28th or 29th of the last month, and where I receive the material only in the second or third of the month. When the earlier occasion, one is I would be accounting, is it should be accounted on the basis of the receipt of the goods, or it is, should be accounted on the basis of the date of the invoices. What happens basically if I say, if I have to account on second or third of the next month, obviously I will not get the input what I am supposed to get. It may be available in the portal for me for the next month. In this, more specifically on this, suppose what happens during the year end? How do we handle this issue?
So basically it comes down to the fundamental question is whether GST law allows me to claim a credit in respect of invoice which is dated July, but the underlying goods are received by me in August. So the provision states that you can claim credit only on receipt of goods. Okay. So your entry in the accounting system should be on the basis of your GRN date, because legally you're not entitled to claim the credit unless you have received the goods or the service. So if you receive a bill which is dated July, whereas the goods are received in August, you will claim that credit in the month of August, but while furnishing your inward statement, you will quote the supplier invoice date as July.
Okay. You are talking about the software availability for the cross-checking before we could file our GST or one or thing. This software also helps us in terms of all the data available in the invoices, or only to the extent of your GST, IGST and CGST. For instance, suppose we in our side, we enter the invoice numbers wrong. Let's say maybe there'll be various invoices the same day, possibly. I'm trying to be more, I mean, it may be a little this thing, but still, what happens that, does the software checks even the invoice number also, the whatever you're talking about the software?
Yeah, so as I just explained earlier, say you have an invoice number which you have quoted incorrectly, but you have quoted the date, the value, the TIN of the supplier and the tax amount correctly. So what this software will typically do is, it will try to collate data. It would color, what softwares I have seen is, they color the data which, so where all the invoice numbers are incorrect but other things are matching, they will color it with pink. Where the date is mismatching but other elements are matching, they would color all those datas with green. So depending on, they would try to group errors, whether the errors are on the tax amount, whether the error is on invoice amount, whether the error is on the invoice date, and then would show those entries which are coming from the supplier's GSTR1, which the software thinks is possibly where you've gone wrong. So even before your data goes onto the portal, say you file incorrect data on the portal would accept it because you are supposed to self-assess your return. You will upload that data. But if you have this intermediate software, which tries to reconcile. So typically it's called a process of reconciliation. If you faltered somewhere, it tells you you can correct this. So at least to that extent, the data that is going on the portal remains accurate, remains correct, and your credits don't mismatch for these petty reasons.
But GSTR1 is available for revising any given point of time?
Under
beyond
the
3 days, whatever time given, beyond that, are we allowed to revise our GSTR1?
No. So GST returns, none of the GST returns are allowed to be revised. You can rectify a mistake in the subsequent return that you file, but you cannot revise a return which is already filed. Now here what mistake people are doing is, there are three buttons. One, the data goes onto the portal. Next, you save that data. Then you file that data, sorry, then you submit that data, and then you upload that data. Once you click the submit button, whatever data is entered by your software or you by manually gets freezed. You cannot change. Then you have the only option to upload it. So typically what people have done is, either people have paid 10 lakhs as tax in the cash ledger, and then by mistake in the summary return that we are filing right now, form number 3B, are entering the liability as 2 lakhs. Mistakes have happened where people have declared liability of 4.5 crores instead of 45 lakhs. So that 10 matters. You have to be very, very sure about the tax liability. It warns you before submitting. Are you sure you want to submit? So you have to ensure that you read that warning correctly and ensure that the output liability is shown correctly, because you cannot revise the return.
Oh, that means...
I'll just before that. At present, you're filing only summary return, where you have that leeway of revising data when you file the GSTR 1, 2 and 3. So the return 3 is what... So return 3, GSTR 3 has two parts. Part A is auto-populated based on GSTR 1 and 2 that you file. Part B is nothing but the 3B that you're filing. So if you've made a mistake in 3B, you can definitely rectify while filing your GSTR 3, but that is only a transition till December that you have. You have that window open to revise the incorrect, the mistakes that you made in your 3B.
But basically, if GSTR 1 is not able to revise, and if you say that it's been submitted, actually, I would say that is the person who is going to get the input is going to be affected. Obviously, suppose this time I file in a GSTR 1 with a wrong entry, if I say I'm not able to revise it, only the purchaser has been deprived of his input.
So what will happen is, say you filed a GSTR 1 and you showed your tax liability against a particular customer as rupees 10 lakhs instead of 1 lakh. You file your GSTR 1 on the 10th. Okay, so typically going forward, moving forward, the due date would be 10th of the following month. You would apply that, you would upload the data. You have incorrectly mentioned the tax amount as 10 lakh instead of 1 lakh. Your customer would get that data in his form 2A, where he will see that credit flowing from you as 10 lakhs. If he is not greedy enough, what he will do is, he will say, I do not accept this, and he will amend that. He will amend that to show that I accept rupees 1 lakh based on the invoice that I have. Once he does that, you will get, as a supplier, a report in form GSTR 1A, which will say that, look, you have shown the output tax against this customer as rupees 10 lakhs. The customer says this is 1 lakh. And if you accept that flagging, automatically your GSTR 1 gets corrected and the liability goes from 10 lakhs to 1 lakh. So this happens between 10th and 15th. Even if, now it's quite possible that the customer is greedy and he says that, okay, you've shown 10, I'll take 10. In that case, definitely there's a problem. You'll have to once pay that tax. And then that customer will have to accept a credit note that you issue, that look, I have done this mistake. You have been greedy enough taking that credit. So now I'll issue a credit note to you. You reverse the excess credit that you've taken earlier. You can then subsequently claim the reversal in the subsequent month's output liability. Yes, but for 1 month, you're losing 9 lakhs.
Debit notes for the current month's sales, return can be issued in the next month?
So when you say debit note, from the supplier's perspective, it is credit notes. Under GST, a debit note or a credit note, both issued by the recipient is not relevant. A credit note, debit note only issued by the supplier is what is relevant. So when there is a sales return, the supplier has to issue a credit note against the debit note of the recipient or the customer. Once the supplier issues a credit note, it will appear in the 2A report of the customer saying that, look, you've returned these many goods. The tax component to the value of return is this much. As a recipient, he will reduce the excess credit that he has taken on your invoice earlier. Only when he reduces that, when he accepts the credit note of the supplier, correspondingly the supplier will be allowed to reduce his output tax liability in the subsequent month. This credit note by the supplier against the debit note of the client, customer, can be issued any time till the month of September 18 for all the invoices that are issued during the period 2017-18. Beyond September 18, the supplier cannot claim reversal of the excess tax that he has paid in respect of goods that have been returned to him. At the same time, the recipient cannot take credit of goods which he has already returned. So it's a double whammy. The supplier loses that much tax, and the input tax credit of the recipient also goes down because he's not received those goods, he sent those goods back.
See, this is basically a question of our industry, more specific now. All this time you were talking about general GST. We've got a lot of issues in terms of documentation. For instance, we buy deep freezers, 20, 50, 100, whatever it may be, and we tell the supplier, the bill will be on our name, and tell the supplier to deliver it in 10 outlets. What is the document the supplier should carry? Because if the billing will be on our name, it could be, I don't know, it could be sometimes, in a rare case, it could be on a head office bill, it could be interstate or intrastate. So the document that what this typical supplier of freezers to carry to deliver this material.
So as I understand, there is a company called ABC, which is into manufacturing of ice creams or a retail outlet. Company ABC has three outlets in state A and three outlets in state B. But the procurement of deep freezers is done centrally by ABC, the main outlet in state A. The vendor would supply these deep freezers centrally from his manufacturing or the warehouse to six outlets, three which are located in the same state and three which are located in state B. I just mentioned earlier that you cannot claim credit unless you have received the goods. So the exception to this is where on the direction of the main outlet, the vendor supplies the goods to other outlets, you can still claim credit because there is a specific exception. Yes, so what will happen is this is a bill to ship to transaction. As far as the outlets that are concerned, which are in the same state, the invoice would be billed to ABC main office or the main outlet, shipped to the individual outlets. It will go under the delivery challan where the buyer would be mentioned, the consignee would be mentioned, same like what we had in excise. When we talk about outlets that are outside the state, say in state B, we have a concept of distinct persons. So now when you have two registrations under the same PAN, so ABC has one GSTN in state A and another GSTN in state B. The supply is happening through ABC to a unit of a different GSTN in the state B. So there will be two supplies. One supply from the vendor to ABC and the second supply from ABC to its outlet in state B. Supplies between these two tins, though under the same PAN, would be a deemed supply. So one, the movement of the goods will be under cover of the invoice by the vendor stating ship to, bill to state A outlet, ship to state B outlet. But subsequently, there would be an invoice issued by the main outlet in state A to the outlet in state B. And this is the invoice based on which state B outlet would claim credit.
What happens when we give you free ice creams for promotional activities?
This is the most dangerous question which I can get. So there are two provisions under GST law. One is, so I said that supply has to be in the course of business. It should be for a consideration. What is the exception to this? If you're making a supply, one, you're hit, so you get input credit only if the supply, the outward supply either is in furtherance of business, but it cannot be free. So what happens when it is free? So there's a section 17.5 in input tax credit provisions which says that any goods given as free, you have to reverse the credit which you took because there is no taxable output that you're not paying tax on your output. It says that input tax credit shall not be available in respect of any goods which are disposed of as free samples or gifts. Second provision is contained in Schedule 1. So generally, every supply which is in the course and furtherance of business and for consideration is what is taxable. Schedule 1 carves an exception and says, any permanent disposal of business asset where input tax credit has been claimed shall be a deemed supply and you have to pay tax. So what is a practical solution to this? Say generally you're selling ice creams for rupees 100. Instead of going into this hassle of whether I should reduce the input credit or whether I should pay tax under Schedule 1, it's best to under-invoice it. You invoice it at 10 rupees. As far as the receiving outlet is not related to you, there is no problem. If it is related to you, it becomes a deemed supply. At market value, you have to pay tax. But if that outlet is a franchisee, obviously it's not related to you. In that case, the question is whether I should reverse credit or whether I should offer it to tax at market value. So when there are two provisions, now this, as far as the retail outlet is concerned, I don't see much issue. You can identify the sale to the purchase and you can reverse the input tax credit. Once you have not taken credit, there is no question of deemed sale under Schedule 1. When it comes to manufacturer, the biggest problem is how do I compute? You can contact Mr. Narasimhan, he's a cost accountant.
Exactly, that is going to be the next question. Like, if you are going to say that we have to adjust the input, how do I quantify my input? How do I calculate my input? On my side, let's say we have got a 1 liter potty pack where we're given a 250 ml extra. So this 250 ml, how do I calculate my input rate on this 250 ml based on whatever input I availed on my basic input? How do I coordinate?
So I'll tell you the simple answer to this, a very conservative approach is, when you say no input tax credit will be available in respect of goods given as free samples or gifts. As a manufacturer, the input tax credit is taken in respect of raw materials and not what you're giving as free. So the debate is whether you can actually say that I will be liable to reverse credit. Department will always say that you already took credit on the raw materials and now you're distributing as free. It's a permanent disposal of business asset. If the intention was to restrict this to fixed assets or capital assets, they should have mentioned the term as capital assets. Unfortunately, Schedule 1 says any business asset. Is my stock business asset? I think it's a business asset. So the conservative approach would be to offer it for tax under Schedule 1 as far as manufacturers are concerned. As far as traders are concerned, it's easy to identify. The larger problem is there is no mechanism provided in the rules how to compute. Unlike excise, which said that if goods are lost or destroyed, you reverse the input credit, and they had a mechanism to do it. Correct? So now I don't know whether your cost accounting standards would help. But yes, today it's a debatable issue whether input should be reversed or you should offer for tax. But yes, as far as related outlets are concerned, the manufacturer's own flagship stores are concerned, you will have to pay tax at market value. It's as good as sending the deep freezers.
Coming back to EVA bill. EVA bill has been exempted for ice creams. Does it come under?
No, I don't see that as a...
There is no exemption for any of the product.
No, I don't see it in the list. They've provided a list of products which are not...
I guess it's milk products are exempted for EVA.
I did go through that list. I couldn't see milk products.
Next question from somebody from China. How to cancel GST number for dealers? This is for, we are talking about our dealers. Who are comes under a composite tax?
So see, what has happened?
By mistake, they have gone to the, from transitional, they moved to GST. Now they say they are within the threshold limit of whatever, 20 lakhs. Earlier it was 10 lakhs in Karnataka typically. Now there is a threshold limit of 20 lakhs. Now they wanted to cancel. But what we found, there is no provision in the portal or wherever it may be to cancel your GST number. There is a provision where you can go and cancel your VAT. But what is happening, before that you could realize there are a lot of love letters from the office saying that you are not filed your, you are not paid your, how do you handle this issue?
See, now there are two issues. One, which is you have been allotted a provisional ID, which is typically your GSTN, by the department. So either Central Excise has issued the provisional ID or the VAT department has issued the ID or the service tax department has issued an ID. To the extent that ID has been issued, but you have not migrated. There is a mechanism, at least in Maharashtra, what the department is doing, that you go and apply, you have to file a 103 to cancel your erstwhile VAT number. They automatically cancel your provisional also and the VAT number also. But legally how to do it, there's a particular form. Yes, the portal is not yet equipped for doing all this. So till that point of time, you are a registered person, you'll have to pay tax.
So post-migration, you have to necessarily...
Post-migration, you can do it. Many people are just filing letters saying that we are not able to do it on the portal, so we are not going to collect tax. And we will cancel our registration retrospectively from 1st July. Now, how this mechanism is going to work is not known because the portal is not accepting many things. Like I have company's name changed from a private limited to a public limited, but I'm not able to update portal because it's still not allowing me to change the core fields. So there are issues. It's a transition phase. I'm sure it would start happening in days to come. But yes, there is a problem where you have migrated already. There is a problem of whether I should collect tax and pay or no.
Is it obligatory to identify the, when you do in the reversal mechanism taxing, to identify the supplier or service provider?
Okay. So what I understand is that you have to pay tax on every unregistered purchase. Okay. So even if you buy a sandwich for, so when I go to my client and he asks me, what do you want to eat? If I say I want to eat sandwich, he might just go down and there is a roadside vendor who offers sandwich. It's an unregistered inward supply to me. I have to pay tax. Whether I have to identify the supplier. So as far as preparing the self-invoice is concerned, when you have a supply happening from an unregistered person to you, being a registered person, you have to generate the tax invoice. So the rules say that you can issue a single invoice for all the unregistered inward supplies that you have received during a month at the end of the month. So far, so good, you need not identify. But there are so many documents that you have to issue. I don't know how the accounting system is going to manage to issue. It says that when you receive an inward supply from an unregistered person, you have to issue a payment voucher to him. And if you read what the contents of payment voucher are, they said you have to name of the supplier, GST if he's registered, the address, everything has to be mentioned. So though the invoice need not identify, but your system has to capture.
Is it applicable even for the exempted goods?
No, it does not apply to exempted goods because the RCM that you have to pay in respect of unregistered inward supplies is only in respect of taxable inward supplies. So if it is exempted, there is no obligation on you to do that.
Now the floor is open for any questions.
I have one general question, which is since beginning of the GST implementation.
Can you be louder?
Yeah, I have a general question, not a very difficult question, but most of the, after GST, there was a confusion about negative list. Ice cream has been kept in negative list with cigarette and pan masala. Okay.
No, so what do you mean by negative list?
Narasimhan sir.
We are basically, even if you are a manufacturer, you are not eligible for your composite tax. 75 lakhs, you are not eligible. They have, unfortunately, they have classified under tobacco, ice cream, all in the same. The reason being given, either the input, you're not, ITC is not much, or they say input is hazard nuts. Very, very unfortunate for us as ice cream industry is concerned, because I but by no stretch of imagination, you can compare an ice cream with a tobacco. Okay, anyway, now I don't, is there anything to do with Mr. Mehta? I don't know. It is only the government which has decided, which the association has
decided. I think you've not approached at the right time.
True.
No lobbying.
Sir, main kisi shaadi mein.
Whatever exempted limited, you are not eligible for 75 lakh exemption, even if you are a manufacturer.
Sir, we as chartered accountants are telling our clients that don't buy from unregistered people, don't buy from composition dealers. So whether composition, so when Mr. Adia in one press conference, somebody asked him that we have to pay tax on every unregistered purchase. What's the whole idea of this 20 lakhs? So he said that is meant for Pan Bidi shop, not for everyone. Agar aap bade karobar ko supply kar rahe ho, to aapka karobar bada hi hona chahiye. This is what he replied. And I believe we had another statement coming saying that we need everyone to register. This 20 lakhs is not relevant. Same way 75 lakhs is an eyewash.
Main kisi shaadi mein 20 packet ice cream bechta hu aur us pe 10 lagte hain, 10 wapis return ho jate hain, to iska billing invoicing kis tarah se hoga?
I didn't get your question, sir.
Sir, main kisi shaadi mein 20 packet ice cream bechta hu aur bhejne ke baad pata lagta hai ki wahan pe 10 lage aur 10 return aa gaye, uski invoicing डिलीवरी चालान पे होगी, बिल बना के भेजना पड़ेगा, क्रेडिट नोट बनाना पड़ेगा, किस तरह से क्या करना चाहिए मैं?
सर, अगर आप वो आइसक्रीम केटरर के थ्रू बेचते हैं तो क्रेडिट नोट का कॉन्सेप्ट होगा. अगर बी टू सी है तो यू हैव टू जस्ट क्लेम क्रेडिट ऑफ व्हाटएवर, यू हैव टू जस्ट रिवर्स, यू हैव टू नॉट रिपोर्ट इनवॉइस लेवल डिटेल्स. सो व्हाट विल हैपन, जुलाई में आपने आइसक्रीम बेचा, नेक्स्ट डे वो आइसक्रीम वापस आ गया, सेम डे वो आइसक्रीम वापस आएगा.
तो सर वो डिलीवरी चालान पर भेज सकते हैं या
See, e-way bill ka concept kaise evolve hone wala hai mujhe nahi pata. Even when you mentioned about the freezers, so who will issue the e-way bill? Whether the manufacturer or the person who is selling the freezers is going to issue the e-way bill as far as your outlets in state B are concerned, or you as ultimately who is a person who is supplying those freezers directly from the vendor, whether you have to issue the e-way bill. So the e-way bill says the GSTN of the recipient. So recipient in all purposes for GST law means the person who is paying and the place of delivery. So view can be taken that the delivery will happen from the freezer manufacturer. He will issue the e-way bill and he will mention the place of delivery as the person, your outlet in state B. Same way in your case, whether 20 packets would cost more than 50,000.
No, it is only 20,000 or it may be 10,000 only.
So if it is below 50,000, you don't have to issue e-way bill.
No, e-way bill is not a matter. Whether we have to issue the bill or not.
You have to issue invoice for every supply that is going. Supply for consideration, which we, I think, will be comfortable saying that a sale would always be under the cover of an invoice. There are many people still selling goods at under delivery chalan. Abhi tak to koi nahi pakad raha hai. But jis din ye log free ho gaye, department people are free now. They're not doing anything, but still they are occupied with VAT assessment, excise.
और सर जब वो नाइट में वापस रिटर्न आता है तो मुझे किस तरह से काउंटिंग करनी पड़ेगी उसकी
नहीं वापस आएगा तो सी द रेसिपिएंट कैन नॉट इशू द ई-वे बिल
नहीं वो डायरेक्ट पार्टी पे
सो यू प्रोबब्ली कैन टेक एन अंडरटेकिंग फ्रॉम हिम दैट यू रिसीव्ड यू रिजेक्टेड दिस मेनी योर रिटर्न बैक दिस मेनी व्हेन इट इज बी टू सी देयर इज नो डॉक्यूमेंट इफ इट इज बी टू बी थ्रू केटरर
इट इज बी टू सी
या
इट इज ऑल अबाउट द बी टू सी
सो इफ इट इज बी टू सी देन ओनली योर चलन विल से और योर इनवॉइस विल से दैट रिटर्न दिस मेनी. As of now, you cannot expect that consumer to issue a e-way bill to you. Or probably for that movement, you'll have to again file an e-way bill from that place to back to your factory or your outlet. Ice cream koi wapas nahi bechta hai, sir.
Sir, Rajasthan mein to return hoti hai. Abhi tak.
Good evening, brother. I am Manjeev Agarwal from Ambala. I have an inquiry that suppose we buy milk powder from Gujarat and we sell it to West Bengal. Earlier we were doing this transaction under even sales, but now we do not, and we have to maintain the secrecy of our supplier and the price. So there is a column on the invoice that ship to, but we do not want to declare it to our supplier that who is our customer. So to maintain the business secrecy, we can't sell tell it to our supplier, and the consignment will move from Gujarat to West Bengal. And en route, I have to change the bill like it was in even sales. So what is the procedure now?
See, this is a practical issue. You will have to send an invoice to that person and ensure that the original supplier moves the goods under your invoice.
Otherwise, you will not get input.
No, but,
otherwise, you will not get input.
Otherwise, no, input will be claimed based on his invoice. So where he is procuring goods from Gujarat and sending those goods to West Bengal, he is in Maharashtra. He will issue an invoice to the ultimate consumer, the consignee. But since he says what he means is that if those goods move, when I gave the example of the freezer, the bill to and ship to.
What we are doing at present is, like I am based in Ambala, that is in Haryana. So we purchased goods from Gujarat. And en route, we changed the bill. And suppose it is in Indore now, because from Gujarat to West Bengal, Indore is on en route. So we write on the reverse of the LR, we do an endorsement. We hereby certify that we have purchased this consignment from Amul, having GST number this, by paying IGST this, under their invoice number this and dated this, and further sold to XYZ Kolkata, having GST number this, by charging IGST 5% under our invoice number. We give a certificate like this on the reverse of the LR and put our stamp and signatures rubber seal. And that is what we are doing at present. Is it all right?
Currently, it's a sale in transit, but under GST, it cannot move on the LR. LR is not a document which is recognized.
Later on, it will be into this.
No, your goods, if you want to ensure that your ultimate consumer in Kolkata does not know what your cost is.
That is the main.
Then you should try and issue a digitally signed invoice, send it to the vendor who is the original manufacturer in Gujarat, ask him to start the movement under your invoice. and to ensure that he does not give the invoice to the customer, his invoice to the customer. He carries two invoices. One, the invoice of the original manufacturer
the
in Gujarat.
Carrier, the truck people. The truck driver should carry on, one invoice only. What?
No, no. The original manufacturer, your vendor
okay,
in Gujarat.
Principal manufacturer.
Principal manufacturer will issue an invoice, bill to and ship to. The movement will happen under that invoice, but you'll have to back send to the vendor, the principal manufacturer in Gujarat, your invoice, which should be digitally signed. And he should ensure that the invoice that reaches in the hands of your client is your invoice and not his invoice.
But how do I maintain my business secrecy from my supplier?
Because he will not hand over that invoice to him.
No, but as you said, I have to give my my invoice to the supplier. So how do I maintain my secrecy from the supplier?
So that's a challenge. Then you'll have to ensure that goods come to you and then go. Or you'll have to take a GST in Gujarat. Have a person there receiving the goods, claim credit, and then set the goods. I understand it's a practical difficulty. There are practical difficulties where goods are coming on port.
I wrote an email to this GST help desk, and there was no answer, although they acknowledged it. But
written several questions to the Twitter handle also. They answer only what questions are there in the FAQ.
Okay.
So if a question is there in the FAQ, they tweet and answer your question. Otherwise, they never answer.
One more small inquiry, like Diwali is fast approaching. Suppose I get 100 pieces of a gift manufactured by someone in Moradabad and I get it to Ambala and then I send one each piece to my different customers all throughout the country. I pay GST to my supplier and book it as a Diwali expense. But how do I give any invoice or a paper to the courier to deliver that gift to the customer and the value of that product may be 2,000 rupees or 3,000 rupees.
If it is free, it can go under the cover of a delivery challan or the e-way bill when it comes.
At present, like in another 15-20 days.
At present, it can go on a delivery challan.
It can go on delivery challan.
And but no GST number, nothing is to be mentioned?
No, if it is B2B gifting, then yes, the delivery challan format also requires to give all the details as good as an invoice.
So the customer, how do I tell it? That this is a gift item and it is a personal item basically.
Yeah, but it has to move under a delivery challan.
Right. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. With this, we have concluded this session. Let's give a big round of applause, Mr. Chirag Mehta, for a wonderful explanation on the GST.